the night we met. Can't remember what I said, but I bet it wasn't cool. I was close to death with you in that perfect dress, knowing that it's hard or head and breaking all the rules. Just like, don't fall in love before I know your name. Holding out, hoping that you feel the same. No, I've never been one for sounding cliche, but it's true. All I do is think about you. All I do is think about you. All I do is think about how your leap of faith made me put all my faith in you. So all I do is think about no regrets, not even the nights we spent fighting our patience meant. Holding up a mirror to myself, learning to reflect, because love like this doesn't come round all the time. And letting you get away would be a crime, 'cause half of your heart makes a whole lot of this heart of mine. Ooh, all I do is think about you.
Bamenda One Council this morning. It's a privilege having you here and want to wish you a happy new year. I know there are many councils around the town where you could have gone to for your marriage, but you preferred Bamenda One. And so we are honored by your choice and we heartily thank you for choosing us. Bamenda One is a place of hospitality and security. As you sit in here, you relax, feel comfortable. There is nothing to be afraid of. Once more, you're welcome. Have your seats, please. The presence of the Administrator General of Prisons, Mr. Nganjo Damia Mama, the Senior Administrator of Prisons, Mr. Ayub Bernard Abuo, and the Regional Delegate of Small and Medium-Sized Enterprise for the Northwest Region. I equally, on a special note, want to acknowledge the presence of Professor Pakenshi of the University of Bamenda here present, and every other very important person that are here, because I consider all of you very important to have been here this morning. All of you are welcome. We acknowledge your presence and we are happy having you here this morning. Thank you for coming. My dear friends, we are all gathered here this morning to celebrate one of life's greatest moments, to give recognition to the worthy and beauty of committed marital love, and to add our best wishes to the worlds which shall unite. If you hear your name, you answer present. Fru Renee and Miss Pat, Shunika.
Present.
All right, I would like to know from the family members, who gives Shulika's hand in marriage?
I am present.
Good morning, sir.
Thank you.
The way you are so anxious about it. I'm sure your pockets have been filled. So are you saying that Renee's family has done the necessary traditional rites.
If they didn't do it, I would not be here.
And we have these patients because most often some of our youngsters, when they fall in love, and the parents are like questioning why this person, why this woman or that man, they will just ignore them and then come here with their friends and they come and sign as witnesses to their marriages. And then soon after, we get parents complaining that the government is issuing marriage certificates to their children without their consent. So we do this in order to be sure that the girl who is leaving her family to join another family is actually being sent out or given out by her parents and not just by street people. I hope we are okay with that.
Yes.
Thank you so much. I will want the couples to stand up. I'll give you lectures at once, and after that we'll treat you couple by couple. All right. The commitment that all of you are about to make is the most important commitment that two people can make in life. You are about creating something new, the marriage relationship, an entity which never ends. And I want to find out from you people standing here if you are aware that what you are about doing here is creating something new. Are you aware of that? I'm talking to all of you. Are you aware of that?
Yes.
And that this something new will never end?
Yes.
When we say you are about creating something new, we mean that you have not been married before. So you are about getting married. That is the newness in what you want to create here. And this something new will never end. When we say it will never end, we mean that marriage is a covenant for life. It is not an adventure where you want to go and try and see if it will work or not. It is not a contract that you have come here to sign with the person you have come with, such that if tomorrow you go and things are not the way you thought they would be, you can put an end to that contract. Marriage is a covenant for life. And I want to remind you of the fact that marriage is that journey that everybody wants to go, but very few people want to get to the end of that journey. And because very few people want to get to the end of the journey, we say that is a contract, not marriage. If you are wanting to be married or prepared to be married, you should be prepared to get to the end of that marriage. As you stand here, it is love that has brought you people this far. And that love is a great responsibility, while marriage is a journey to eternity. You will soon be taking your vows here for better, for worse, till death do us part. That is the eternity in it. So, my dear couples, I want to remind you that the decision you have taken to be married today is a very serious decision that somebody can take in life. And so you should be prepared to take this decision to the end of your life. And so with that said, I want to ask you these questions. As you stand here today, are you now prepared to begin this commitment with one another in marriage? If so, you say, yes, I am.
Yes, I am.
Have you come here freely and without reservation to offer yourselves to each other in marriage? If so, you say, yes, I have.
Yes, I have.
My dear sisters and brothers, I want to remind you of the fact that God created man and woman equal in dignity. When I talk of equality in dignity, I'm not using the feminist argument which claims that a woman is equal to a man.
Because if you look at you physically and biologically, there is no way a woman can be equal to the man. But when I talk of equality in dignity, I mean that God created each of you with a certain degree of dignity that has to be maintained. And for that dignity to be maintained, there are certain principles that you must put into practice. You know, we have gone through war in the two Anglophone regions, and it is because the Anglophones feel that their dignity is not respected in Cameroon as Anglophones. And you can see how that lack of respect has taken us far. It will be the same in your marriage if you fail to respect each other, because each of you will be able to maintain that dignity as a result of the respect that you have from your spouse. So the first principle that will keep your marriage going is respect. Be ready to respect each other. That respect should be a two-way drive. The man should not say, you don't respect me as a wife, whereas he himself does not respect the woman. Your wife equally has a degree of dignity that she must maintain. And for that dignity to be maintained, you need to respect her. And remember that if you respect each other out of love, there will be no reason for any problems in your marriage. When you cannot respect, there is bound to be problems. So respect is primordial in your marriage. Make sure you respect each other. The second principle is humility. There is this saying that humility is the key to success. Everybody that is humble is always successful. If you are humble, you mind the type of words you utter to your spouse. You polish your tongue each time you want to talk to your spouse. But if you are proud and arrogant, you don't care what you say. You don't care how your spouse feels with the type of words you utter to him or her. And so a humble person will obviously want to say things that will not be hurting, that will not cause problems. And to you, the young ladies, a humble woman becomes a charm, a natural charm to her husband. If you are humble as a woman, you become a natural charm to your husband. We hear people accusing, particularly in-laws, accusing their daughter-in-laws of having charmed their husbands. I know of recent, we have been hearing about Kayamata, that young girls go after Kayamata to charm men. To me, I believe that is fake. I don't believe in such things. Even if it works, it is temporary. And what if the man discovers that you have been using charm on him? It will be too bad for you as a woman. And so I advise you, my young ladies, use God's natural charm, which is humility. If you are humble, you become a natural charm to your husband. And that man will obviously love you till the end. He will take care of you. He will provide for you. He will protect you, rather than run after artificial things. Another key principle is patience. Remember, you have grown up in different families, with different upbringing, different backgrounds. And as you are getting married to the person with whom you have come here today, you will not expect that person to start behaving exactly like yourself. There will be differences in the way you behave. But if you are patient with one another, you will have time to study yourselves, and you'll be able to understand why your spouse behaves the way he or she does. And you'll be able to adapt to that person's way, and you people will live a happy marital life. But if you are not patient, you rush to conclusions, and you may start condemning your spouse without knowing who that person is. You have not taken time to know who your spouse is. If you get home as a wife and you start telling your husband, you must give me 10,000 food money every day, when have you taken time to know how much he earns a month to be able to be giving you 10,000 francs. Take time to study your spouse. Be it the wife, be it the husband, you will be able to understand each other and your marriage will not go on the rocks. Every marriage is unique. There will be no need for you to be comparing your marriage with any other marriage. Every marriage is unique. Don't go back and start saying because your friend's husband is giving her 10,000, your own husband must give you 10,000. You don't know how your friend's husband gets his own money. So there is no cause for you to be competing or comparing your marriage. Another key word you must practice is peace. I think we have lived a period of war and we know how painful it is. We have lived in ground zero and we know what war is all about. If you get home and you cannot make peace in your marriage, you will also find yourselves in ground zero. There are times that you hear that a man has packed and left his home, or a woman has packed out of her home, and you don't question, but what can be the cause? That home has been made a ground zero, and it is unfit for one of the spouses to live in. That is why you see people running out of their marriages. Please, make your home peaceful. When you make your home peaceful, you'll be able to enjoy your marriage. You'll be able to consume your marriage and bring up the children that God is going to bless you with. But if you make it a war zone, you put yourselves in a small hell on earth. And to the women, when you make your home peaceful, you make your husband rushing home each time to spend time with you. Even when at home, at his job site or at his business place, he will be praying for time to pass faster so that he can come back home and enjoy his wife and his home. But if you make it a war place, when he leaves work or the business site, you'll find him roaming the streets or moving from bar to bar because he doesn't see how he can come home. Some of you watch Nigerian films and you want to imitate what Mama G does in films, which is not correct. Please, don't go back and want to be a Mama G in your home. Because if you do that and the man wants to brace up, you may leave or you may be destroyed. We have been seeing on social media how men have been killing their wives. And even women have been killing their husbands. Marriage is not a battleground. If you were thinking of going for a wrestling, it is better you look for a wrestler rather than pretend that you are getting into a marriage where you soon go and become a wrestler or a boxer. Marriage is not a wrestling ground. When there is love, there is no reason for you to start hating. And so you have to do everything to make that love to grow from strength to strength. If you allow it dwindle, you'll soon find yourselves as enemies. And you may come to a point where you will not even want to hear the voice of your spouse, nor set eyes on that spouse. So please, if you have been giving gifts as boyfriend, girlfriend, this is the moment that you should do better. If you have been texting or making phone calls, calling yourselves honey, darling, don't go back and when children start coming, you start tagging your husband's name as Pa Ambe or Pa Neba. Those pet names should continue and you should even improve on them. Because the moment you start shifting that darling to Pa Ambe, it shows that that love has actually gone down. Yes, you do not cherish him anymore. It is now Ambe's father and not your lover. Yes, I will soon ask you to begin to tell one another some things here. And that's where I will know whether actually the love is there or you are just getting married because you want that person to achieve something from the person. So mind you, that time is coming soon. All right, another key principle you should practice is trust. When a woman is trustworthy, your husband can entrust his finances into your care. And when you trust each other, there will be no need for suspicion amongst yourselves. There will be no need for you investigating your spouse if you trust that spouse. And so I believe that because you have come here with the person you are. Because you will soon die of depression, you'll die of hypertension, you'll die of so many other illnesses if you must investigate your spouse. And they may be doing everything possible to ruin your marriage. So, what if you open your husband's phone and you see that a girl who has been longing to get married to him and did not succeed writes to him telling him, "Honey, I wish you had gotten married but to me." You want to strangle your husband, not knowing that that message coming, the person means business. So there is no need for you to even see that. To be at peace, avoid seeing it. I watch a video on social media I always want to quote, with a man and wife sitting in their parlor, together in the parlor, and then the wife's phone rings, and a friend of that woman calls, "Hello, where are you?" And she says, "She's in the house." "You are sitting there, you don't know that your husband is out there with another woman?" Whereas the husband of that woman is right there with her in her sitting room. And because that woman does not trust the husband, she immediately stands up and starts confronting the man. "Where are you? I've heard that they have seen you out there." You see, lack of trust can make you behave like that. Lack of trust can make you behave like that. Even when somebody is right there with you, you still do not believe that he is there. Please, just have trust and confidence in yourselves. When you trust each other, you live peacefully and you avoid some of the illnesses that come with stress. Just have trust for each other. Believe that that man loves you most. That is why he despised every other woman to get married to you. Believe that your wife loves you most. That is why she despised every other man to get married to you. If you do that, you'll have a happy marital life and you'll be able to live in peace. Faithfulness is another key word you must practice. I know that our men by nature are polygamists. But there are still some men who are faithful. And I want to urge you, my couples, that if you live a faithful life, you live a peaceful life. In as much as you keep many wives out there, whether they are wives or concubines or whatever, one wife is one trouble, two wives are two troubles. So the number that you keep multiplies the number of problems that you have. Some men may think that keeping many wives is enjoyment, but there are times that in your inner minds, you regret having taken the decisions that you took. True or false? I'm talking to the men, they will not answer, but that's the truth. All right, so please, even if you were to be a polygamist, make sure that you make your home peaceful in a way that you can live longer. So if you are faithful to one another, there will be no need for suspicion. And you'll find yourselves consuming your marriage happily. To the young ladies, I said some of you watch Nigerian films and you want to imitate what is happening there. I want to urge you that the Bible cautions in the book of Proverbs, chapter 14, verse 1, that a wise woman is that woman who builds her home, and a foolish woman is that woman who pulls down her home with her own hands. Pulling down means you scatter it with your own hands. And how do you scatter? The foolish woman is that woman who thinks that being a talkative is what makes her a woman. I know that for us women, since we don't have strength, we believe that our own force is in our mouths. And so the number of words we utter to a man makes us strong. I tell you, no. That makes you a nagging wife. A woman who wants to quarrel each time and wants to fight the husband each time is a nagging woman. And when you do that, you are the foolish woman that Proverbs 14:1 says. By doing that, you destroy your home. If you are that woman who gossips your husband all round the quarter, you have no secret in your home, you are that woman that is tearing down your home with your own hands. There is no marriage that doesn't have problems. Marriage is not a bed of roses. There will be challenges. When these challenges come, both of you should join your heads together like one person and see how to handle that challenge. It is no reason for you to carry it out there and begin to scandalize it. Scandalizing will only magnify that problem. It won't solve it. Your bedroom is a better place for you to settle your problems. Not even the parlor. Talk less of getting it to your neighbors. So for you to be a wise woman, you have to keep the secrets of your marriage in your house. Don't take them out for any reason. Don't share them with your friends, because those friends may be giving you advice out of jealousy, and you realize that the moment you are stepping out, those same friends will be the one taking your place in your home. So please, keep your problems to yourselves. And to the mothers and father-in-laws, you people have lived your own marriages, and you should be able to advise these youngsters on how they can also enjoy and grow in their own marriages. Don't take sides when they have problems. I know particularly the mothers of the men, I don't train my picking, you can't scissor. That's what they always say. But they fail to understand that they also got married to somebody's own picking and also seized that picking. So please, give room to our youngsters to enjoy their marriage. And when I say so, I'm not telling my young brides to go and start saying that I'm married na ya picking, I no marry na you. If you go and want to claim the man, you will not succeed. You may do that for a while, but it will not end. Because that man cannot abandon his family completely for you. I would rather advise you from experience that if you handle your in-laws well and you cause them to love you as a daughter-in-law, they will fight your cause for you. When you have a problem with your husband, they will come in for you and they will have to settle that matter in your favor. But the moment you start claiming that you don't know them, you know only the man, when they will take sides with their son, you will no longer be there. So please, be the wise woman in the Bible who builds her home. Being wise means you will not be discriminatory. You will not be selfish. You will not be insolent to your in-laws. do everything to bring them together. And it will be same for you, the grooms. You are taking in these young women from their own parents to bring to your own parents. So you should be able to make her loved by your family. And you should also be able to love her own family. Because by the two of you uniting, you have indirectly united your own families. So do everything to keep your families in peace and love. Sometimes when you people get married like this and there is a little problem, you hear somebody saying, I made a mistake to get married to this woman or to this man. I want to remind you today that there is no marriage that is a mistake. Every marriage is God's doing. God has chosen the person with whom you are standing here today, and so it can never be a mistake. What can be a mistake in your marriage is either your character or some other things. If you get home and realize that there is a weakness in your spouse's character, and you identify that weakness, and instead of that spouse thanking you for identifying that weakness of his or hers so that he or she can improve on, and you rather tell your spouse, now my character, I don't feel change him. Have you heard people say that? Then I'm telling you that that is the mistake in your marriage. It is not your marriage that is a mistake, but that character trait of yours is the mistake that can destroy your marriage. So you should be able to appreciate your spouse, identifying the weakness in you, and be ready to change that character trait. Improve on it, because every human being is dynamic, able to change. But if you refuse and say it is your character you cannot change, be ready to leave that marriage, because nobody will want to put up with that type of a character who cannot change. If you get home and you become the lazy type that you want one person to stress for the upkeeping of the family while you are there browsing your phone or watching television day long, that is a mistake in your marriage. You should be able to support your spouse in winning bread for the family. Don't overburden one person. Because if you allow one person to be overburdened, that person will soon crash and the family will suffer. Selfishness is another thing that can break your marriage. Be ready to share with one another. If you love somebody, I don't see how you will not want to share what you have with your spouse. But if you want to be that selfishness is the mistake in your marriage. Not your marriage, but that selfishness. So work very hard on the negatives as far as your marriage is concerned. If you do that, you'll enjoy your marriage and you'll move on successfully. Close your ears to gossips, because many marriages have been broken as a result of gossips. And the telephones you carry are the highest source of gossips today. Because by the time you leave here, the whole world would have known that you are married, and you will start receiving good and bad messages. So close your ears to them. Be focused. You have a long way to go. And so there is no need for you to be distracted. Be focused and move on steadily, and you'll get to the end of your marriage. I know that you all are not perfect human beings, for there is no perfect human being in the world. And so you're bound to commit errors. When you make an error, be ready to apologize to your spouse. That little word sorry can bring down mountains. And when you apologize, the person to whom apology is rendered should be able to accept that apology, forgive that person, and forget about that issue. To err is human, and to forgive is divine. If you are that person who want to begin to pile grudges because your spouse made an error and ask for forgiveness, you pretended to have forgiven, But you keep piling those grudges, bringing the yesterday into today, bringing the last year into today, then you are preparing a time bomb for yourself. Because when those grudges reach a certain level, they can take you into depression. So forgive and forget. When you forgive and forget, you level the grounds and you move on smoothly. But when you keep piling those grudges, you'll soon find a mountain in front of you that you cannot scale. And that's when you start thinking about divorce. But I want to also remind you that divorce is not the solution to any marital problem. Once married and you divorce, what about the kids you have made? There is still a string that attaches the two of you together, and that is even worse than living together in that marriage. So it is better to forgive and forget, because when you do that, you ignore some of those problems and then you can live well. If not, you want to divorce. As I'm telling you, divorce is not a solution to any marital issue, and it has never been. It will never be. When you go to court, it will take you years for you to be divorced. Sometimes they don't even divorce you. They ask you people to go and stay separately. And like that, it is worse than when you were living together. So please do everything to keep your marriage. Make sure you consume it well so that God will bless you. I want to find out if you people are believers. I see there is a Muslim there. You believe in Allah, so you are a believer, I'm sure. So for the others, are you Christians? As a Christian mother, I always urge my couples to build their marriage on the Word of God. If you use the Bible as the rock or the foundation on which your marriage is built, God is going to protect you, He's going to prosper you, and will make you to see your children's children. Amen?
Amen.
Thank you so much.
All right. What marriage option they are going in for. The government authorizes monogamy and polygamy. Ms. Pa, what marriage option do you want?
Monogamy.
What do you say, Renee?
Monogamy.
Is monogamy with joint property or separate? Ms. Pa?
Joint property.
Renee?
Joint property.
Clap for them now. When you have this woman, Mizpah, Shulika, to be your wedded wife, if so, you say, yes, I will.
Yes, I will.
Will you love and comfort her, honor and keep her in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep yourself only unto her as long as you live? If so, you say, yes, I will.
Yes, I will.
Mizpah, Shulika, will you have this man, Fru Rene, to be your wedded husband? If so, you say, yes, I will.
Yes, I will.
Will you love and comfort him, honor and keep him in sickness and in health, and forsaking all others, keep yourself only unto him as long as you live?
Yes, I will.
Since it is your intention to enter into marriage, join your right hand, please. I would like Renee to look at Ms. Pa in the eyes, tell her how you feel, what you think about her and the promises you have for her.
My better half. I feel like my heart is melting. I will always love and cherish you so long as we live together. I pray that God will be our helper as we take this bold step of forming a family.
Amen.
Amen.
Ms. Pa, you have heard him. What do you have to tell him?
Chibi. Thank you for finding me and for completing me. Thank you for choosing me to be by your side in this journey that we are undertaking. I promise to support you in all endeavors, to stand by you no matter what, and to help build the family together. Amen.
All right. Have you taken her ring? Yes, your left hand. Then support with your left. You say I and you call all your names. Then you give me whatever I say.
I, Rene G.
Do take you.
Do take you when we miss Patricia.
To be my wife.
To be my wife.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
As long as we both live.
As long as we both live.
Take this ring.
Take this ring.
As a sign of my love.
As a sign of my love.
My commitment.
My commitment.
And fidelity to you.
And fidelity to you.
Amen.
Amen.
Fashuka.
Do take you.
Do take you. Through Renechi.
To be my husband.
To be my husband.
To have and to hold.
To have and to hold.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
For better or for worse.
For better or for worse.
For richer or for poorer.
For richer or for poorer.
In sickness and in health.
In sickness and in health.
To love and to cherish.
To love and to cherish.
As long as we both live.
As long as we both live.
Take this ring.
Take this ring.
As a sign of my love.
As a sign of my love.
My commitment.
My commitment.
And fidelity to you.
And fidelity to you.
Amen.
Amen.
And so much as both of you have agreed to live together in matrimony, have promised yourselves the commitment to each other by these vows, by the joining of your hands and the give of these rings, by the authority vested in me by the state of Cameroon, I now pronounce you husband and wife.
Standing next to me, reaching for my heart. Just a smile and there's no way back. Can hardly believe it, yeah. But there's an angel calling me, reaching for my heart. My love on you.
like a once in a lifetime. You changed my world.
Yeah.
the queen.